Original.
Anyway, stick around and learn how to talk Minnesotan if you feel like it.
Let's see, I am also in jail, but the Gordon jail.
Minnesota Centuries, the story of the people, places, and events that have made us who we are. Funding for this series is provided by the St. Paul Companies, providing insurance products and services throughout the world.
MacArthur has been appointed the Supreme Allied Commander to receive the Japanese surrender.
1945. America came home from the most devastating war in human history, armed with the atomic bomb and ferocious optimism. Tired of hard times and sacrifice, the nation was ready to pamper itself in pursuit of the good life, ready to apply our mighty energies to creating a new and thoroughly modern world. And the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul were not to be left out. The great American dream, a secure job, a nice car, a new home in the suburbs, seemed at last within reach as we rushed to embrace the new and improved. Betty Crocker had us baking golden cakes in minutes. Television became part of the family. Southdale, the world's first enclosed mall, made winter shopping a whole new ballgame. You could even pick up a bomb shelter at Dayton's. But there was a downside to this unbridled enthusiasm, for in our rush to remake the world, we discarded huge chunks of the past. And much of our brave new world has already vanished, along with what it replaced. But like the song says, you don't know what you've got till it's gone. So in this next hour, we'll return to the worlds we once knew and relive that optimistic era of big bands and ballrooms, cruising and drive-ins, suburban growth and urban destruction, an era that is part of the continuing story of the lost Twin Cities. The post-war euphoria seemed ordained from the heavens. And from the clouds above came our future, a new double-decker luxury airliner that called the Twin Cities its home, the Boeing Model 377 Stratocruiser. The war was a boom time for aviation in the Twin Cities. We had our own Rosie the Riveters out at the Bomber Modification Plant in St. Paul. Former housewives and secretaries installed everything from machine guns to radar on B-24s and B-25s. And Northwest Airlines supplied an aerial lifeline to our forces in the Pacific. And at the end of the war, a grateful nation gave the Twin Cities airline new commercial routes to Hawaii, Japan, and the Far East. And the airplane that ushered in this new era flew out of Old Chamberlain Field in July of 1949.
Well, friends, this is a real treat. We're now up in the main office of this $2 million Boeing Stratocruiser. There's Harry Muldoon. He's first officer. He's from Bloomington, all these fellas are from the Twin Cities. Would you like a flight check? Well, let's talk to Captain Joe Ostrowski and get our position.
Well, folks, we're now over Flathead Lake. We're at 16,000 feet, and we're traveling 315 miles an hour.
It was the wonder of its age, the fastest, biggest, most comfortable passenger airplane the world had ever seen. And the people just loved it.
Settle down and enjoy the luxury and comfort of the Stratocruisers, for they are the world's largest and finest commercial airliners. You'll marvel at the hot, delicious meals served while you sit comfortably in deep reclining seats.
The plane's big belly made it easy to spot, and its first-class seats came with fold-down berths that promised accommodations as restful as sleeping on a cloud. The plan, a reworked bomber design, reflected both the can-do know-how of World War II and the slightly overstuffed luxury of the 50s. Northwest became the only airline to use Stratocruisers for domestic flights, and passengers couldn't believe their size. What time does this place get to New York? Someone asked a stewardess. The Stratocruiser featured all sorts of special attractions on board. The Hawaiian Express with hula dancers and guitarist Johnny Pineapple. And on Strato fashion flights from Chicago to Minneapolis, passengers saw the latest styles from the Young Quinlan department store, modeled by University of Minnesota co-eds. One other airplane had a spiral staircase leading down to a sumptuous lounge. Here you could find aviation's first sky-high highball. Problem was, in those days, the crew had to enforce the liquor laws of whatever state they flew over. So a plane leaving New York City took orders on the ground and served drinks over New Jersey. It was last call before Pennsylvania, and the bar opened again over Ohio, with then added 3% liquor tax. But then party time all the way to Idaho, except on Sundays and election days, of course. Flying could be a sobering experience. In the history of propeller-driven aircraft, few had as many fans as the Stratocruiser, and few were as costly to operate. So with the appearance of jet engines, the slow, gas-guzzling plane was grounded in 1960. But for all its foibles and follies, the Stratocruiser lasted more than a decade and became the standard for air travel, a symbol of an era when hopes were as high as 16,000 feet and we traveled at 300 glorious miles per hour.
Rocket, rocket, rocket!
But in a period obsessed with the modern, nothing set the tenor of the times better than the automobile.
Rocket for 53!
More futuramic than ever with smart new style features both inside and out. Notice the new Rocket hood ornament, which proudly proclaims the 88 is a rocket engine car. Smart new hubcap design, a sweep of gleaming chromium accenting these long flowing lines.
It was deluxe and futuramic. After years of boring black and brown cars, Americans discovered the rest of the rainbow.
They were showpieces. They were becoming the regular showpiece. It was, who's got the pink and yellow and greens and purples and, you know, everything was just going so fast. It was crazy.
Riding along in my automobile, my baby beside me at the wheel. I stole a kiss at the turn of a mile, my curiosity running wild. Cruising and playing the radio, with no particular place to go.
The kids called it cruising, and it lasted all night, every night, powering up and down the strip and back again. And whether it was University Avenue, Central, Lindale, or Lake Street, teenage gearheads revved it up every Saturday night.
If you were looking for a drag, you could find one on University Avenue someplace, somehow. You pull up to the stop sign, they look at you, you look at them out of the corner of your eye, and you rev it up a little bit, let them know that you've got an engine underneath your hood, and they're trying to tell you they got a better one by revving theirs up, and the next thing you know, you're both trying to lay rubber, trying to beat each other down the street, and at the same time, looking for the police, saying, oh God, are we gonna get a ticket for this? I can't even begin to tell you what it meant to a teenager to have a car and the pride they had in it. I mean, you didn't touch his car, you didn't mess with his car. That was a part of who that person was.
People did everything in their cars, and this new car culture gave rise to a new kind of roadside architecture. Bold, theatrically modern, and totally crass. It was a style designed to punch you in the eye on the theory that was the only way to keep you from driving right on by.
It had sort of a quality of innocent tastelessness to it, perhaps is the best way I could describe it. People sort of just put up buildings that they thought would attract people, that would be kind of loud and noisy and fun, and a lot of it was.
But in all of the Twin Cities, no place punched you in the eye as hard as Porky's. A drive-in so loud it barely had to advertise.
My father had minored in psychology, and in one of his last psychology classes, he had learned that the most eye-catching pattern to the human eye were black and yellow checks. Well, previous to this, that had only been used as road hazard signs and such, so he made this garish black and yellow check design on the first Porky's. He wanted people driving down the street to be literally forced to turn their heads, that they couldn't help themselves, and it worked.
Ray Truelson was the undisputed Twin Cities drive-in king, who with his dad, Roy, built four Porky's, jumping on a national trend and turning it into a local phenomenon.
If you make it glorious enough, large enough, and if you convince everybody that this is the place to be, this is where everybody is going to be, this is the largest drive-in around, it fulfills itself. Everybody comes there. And that's what happened.
The first Porky's opened in 1953 on University Avenue in St. Paul, and it was an overnight sensation. Ray then opened two more Porky's on Lake Street in Minneapolis. And finally, he painted his trademark checkerboard on his Lindale drive-in, toned down to red and white by then. They were beehives of activity, with car hops rushing to fill orders in 3 minutes' time.
Sometimes people, just a minute or two later, getting their food out there, with a hamburger garnished to their specifications, they say, this can't be mine. I just ordered it.
We were supposed to just deliver the food and come right back in. I mean, that was our job, you know. Of course, we knew everybody that came in there, so of course, we broke a lot of those rules.
Somebody called 6 minute order. Everybody starts blaming each other. 6 minutes, 6 minutes. How could that take 6 minutes? That was your fault. No. I had the buns over there. It was his fault. He didn't have the fries on there.
To people that lived in the Midway area, Porky's was our area. To those people who lived down in White Bear, Jerry's was theirs. And then there was an A&W root beer stand that was out on Como and Snelling. And the Midway didn't really have anything until Porky's opened up, and it just became an instant hit. I guess when you're young, you're always looking for a job, you know. But the social part was the thing that kept the people there.
I mean, it was like the local scene of what's what, who's who. That was what it was all about. You know, did he get a new car? Where did he get it? Whose car is he driving? Who's she with? That kind of thing, you know, and you'd drive through and you'd look at every car and every person that's in the cars. Do I know them? Do they know me? Look at me, I'm cool. You know, I'm driving my car, right?
Oh, I met my husband there. So, yes. Yes, in fact, I can name you several couples that got married from there.
But as America slipped from the Electrolux 50s into the 60s and 70s, the drive-ins lost out to the drive-throughs. Zoning laws tamed the wild roadside. And the old drive-ins were suddenly as out of date as bobby socks and tail fins.
You know, I don't think when we're doing things in our youth, I don't think we realize all the fun and the good times that we're really having until it's gone. And I do miss it.
One by one, each Porky's closed or converted to sit-down restaurants until the last survivor on University Avenue, flagship of the checkerboard fleet, fell into crumbling disrepair. That is until Ray Truelson, who in 1949 had seen the future in a car, now saw it in nostalgia. And Porky's reopened in 1990 without the car hops this time around, but the hot rods are back. So are the twin burgers, the skin on fries. Sadly, Ray Truelson died as this program was being made. But Porky's still stands, a living roadside museum to a time when cruising the avenue was a teenage way of life. For over 50 years, the great mansions of St. Paul and Minneapolis stood as monuments to the wealth of their owners and the success of their cities. But after the war, it seemed, all that was modern was embraced, and all that was old was now old-fashioned. The mansions were especially vulnerable during this time, and scores of them came down. A number of these architectural deaths were especially painful, for some were masterpieces of 19th-century design. There was, for example, the magnificent Wilder Mansion, whose three-story circular tower had loomed over St. Paul from Cathedral Hill since 1887. Designed by St. Paul architects William Wilcox and Clarence Johnson, the great brick and stone house was built for Amherst Wilder, one of St. Paul's wealthiest men.
It was probably one of the two or three grandest houses on Summit Avenue. The interior finishing of the house was splendid. I mean, most 19th century houses, I refer to them as miniature deforestation projects. And this one had all of the elaborate woodwork that you would expect in a mansion of that vintage.
There was oak for the front hall, bird's eye maple in the main parlor, and cherry in the library. There were marble fireplaces, beveled glass mirrors, ornate plaster ceilings, all of which added to the house's aura of sumptuous Victorian overkill. On an opposing hill, Wilder's brother-in-law built an even bigger mansion. The John L. Merriam House dominated a great row of mansions, which enjoyed a spectacular view of the city from their front windows. The Merriam House was a brownstone fortress, and its most powerful feature was a huge entry arch that cut into the house like the mouth of a cave. Details like the clustered columns, the bold geometric patterns, and even a grotesque winged dog who crouched atop one corner of the house helped to lighten the heavy design. The architectural firm was that of Mould and McNichol, but the romantic touches suggest the work of the legendary Harvey Ellis, a master draftsman who floated from office to office in the 1880s.
Two of the great houses that Ellis probably had a hand in one sort or another were the John Merriam House and the Samuel Gale House, which was by Loring Park in Minneapolis on Harmon Place. A Richardsonian Romanesque in style, which is kind of a heavy, massive, forbidding style. He was able to take that style and somehow make it more romantic, more passionate, more lively.
In Minneapolis, few mansions could match the Samuel Gale House for sheer masonry muscle. Overwhelmingly solid, it was built of Sioux quartzite, a pinkish-red stone from southwestern Minnesota.
It's the hardest building stone quarried in the United States. It's no longer quarried, but at that time it was. And to look at that house and to see the tremendous level of stone craftsmanship that went into it, at the same time to realize how hard and difficult that stone was to work with, it's really pretty amazing.
Ellis's drawings depict the Gale House as a fairy tale. And in true castle-like fashion, it had an incredible tower topped by a cone of stone. Within, no expense was spared, especially in the huge 30 by 45 foot entry hall, which featured oak paneling, an alabaster fireplace, and a grand staircase. Gale spent $100,000 on his mansion and claimed it was built to last 100 years. Even so, the house lasted just 17 years longer than he did, as commercial development advanced on Loring Park. After the turn of the century, the Wilder House got a rather large neighbor, the Cathedral of St. Paul. So it came as no surprise when the Catholic Archdiocese acquired the mansion. Over the next 41 years, the Wilder served as the Archbishop's house until its last occupant, Archbishop Gregory Murray, refused to live there. Too ostentatious, he said. Soon after, the church decided to use the site for a new chancery building. And so it was that in 1959, the Amherst H. Wilder House, a priceless piece of Twin Cities heritage, was torn down, its magnificent tower holding out to the last against the forces of destruction. In 1904, the John Merriam House got an even bigger neighbor when the Minnesota State Capitol rose in marble splendor across the street. So after Merriam's death in 1905, his wife, Helen, offered the house to the state as a governor's mansion. But the state turned it down, and so the house stood vacant until 1927, when the St. Paul Institute took over the mansion and turned it into a museum of natural history. For the next 30 years, it was the destination for thousands of school children.
And generations of St. Paul and Minneapolis school children went into that building. And I always kind of like the idea of the museum being there because it seems to me you've got a great lesson in science and architecture at the same time.
The Institute was later renamed the St. Paul Science Museum and later still became the Science Museum of Minnesota. But in 1959, the museum moved out and the old house, once spurned by the state of Minnesota, now fell into its hands. In 1964, the state demolished the mansion and replaced it with a rather dull but functional administration building. And so perished another irreplaceable piece of the Twin Cities historical fabric. In this time, the homes of the wealthy were not the only ones lost. For on a little side street on the east side of St. Paul, you'll still find offset on a corner lot a tunnel leading from the city above into a large ravine below. It was the only road in or out of a hidden valley, which cradled one of the oldest immigrant settlements in the history of Minnesota. While we lament the disappearance of grand homes and structures, for some, the most painful loss was that of an entire neighborhood. It happened here in a place called Swede Hollow.
The city had announced that one of the slums in the St. Paul was Swede Hollow. And I didn't know this until about years later when they had a documentary at the Historic Society showing the slums of Swede Hollow. And it's 1933. I says I was still living down there. I said that was the best place to be.
Below the mansions on Dayton's Bluff, the modest homes of Swede Hollow nestled in the valley along Phelan Creek. The hollow was named for its earliest arrivals, Swedish peasants who called it Svenska Dalen, or Swedish Dale. And for over a century, it was a haven for wave after wave of poor immigrant families, a hint of Appalachia in the heart of the city.
Imagine this little valley in 1905. Our state census shows us that there were over 1,000 people living in this little valley. You look at it today, you can't picture that. You can't imagine over 1,000 people.
In Sweet Hollow, there was no houses for rent. And I never seen a house for sale. I never seen a for sale house. If you went down there and there was an empty house, you just moved in, that's all. Nobody asked any questions, see.
To those who lived in Sweet Hollow, the world in the city above was called Up on the Street, a place where progress marched on by and modern inventions made life easy. In the hollow, fresh springs provided drinking water. Electricity was unknown. And in true old world fashion, the creek was their sewer.
Of course, the privy was an important part of their life, and it was built over the creek on stilts. And it had to project out enough into the creek. And of course, every time you would get a heavy rain, that would make this very sedate creek a rushing torrent. Those privies, many of them would end up in the far end of the hollow and would have to go be retrieved by their owners.
One of these lower privies that were down with the small stream, now they were a little bit too handy for somebody to drop a flat rock. There was a splash of water up to the opening of the privy, and you could hear a lot of swearing in Italian. I mean, it was unprintable even in Italian. Yeah.
Looming above the hollow to the north was the Hams Brewery, its main brew house, an impressive specimen of industrial architecture. Built of red brick and stone, the brew house was an imposing 5 stories high, with long rows of arched windows, ornate North Germanic gables, and a splendid Baroque dome crowned by a cupola. At its opening in 1894, the expanded Excelsior Brewery drew a crowd of 10,000 curious people. One stop on the tour was the employees' refreshment room, where some workers fortified themselves with 40 or 50 glasses of beer a day. Swede Hollow was the perfect place for brewing beer, with its clear spring water and cool caves for storage. The brewery's owner, Theodore Ham, took full advantage of this, and by 1882 was turning out 30,000 barrels a year. Crowning Dayton's Bluff was the Ham Mansion. For 67 years, the house would create an almost medieval scene, standing like a baronial castle over Sweet Hollow. The house was a Queen Anne confection with its round corner tower, its many gables, and its large arched windows that echoed those of the brewery down the hill. Inside, the house offered 20 rooms, 8 fireplaces, and all the other accoutrements of the good life in the 1880s.
Ham would throw very elegant parties. The band would be imported from the city. It's a good German band. The lawn was all lit with Chinese lanterns. He had tame deer that he kept in a barn below the bluff, and peacocks. And these animals would roam amongst his guests as they danced away the night. And I picture these children climbing up the hill, peering through the lilac bushes and seeing all of this and being, I think, inspired by it, this grandeur when their lives were being lived in abject poverty.
Across the valley on the western slope ran the tracks for the St. Paul and Duluth Railroad. There the Scully Line rumbled through the hollow just a stone's throw from the houses.
At first, you get scared because you see all this vibration going on, and every time the train would go by, how the dishes would rattle in the cupboard, and after a while, you got used to it.
We lived in between tracks. We lived alongside of tracks. You could hear that whistle blow in the wintertime, and it was kind of comforting. You'd be snuggled in your bed, and you'd fall right to sleep. The noise didn't bother us.
By 1920, the Italians grew to be the largest group in the hollow. Speaking very little English, newcomers would arrive by train at Union Depot and walk along the tracks to the northeast, through the railroad tunnels under East 7th Street, and into the valley. There they would be directed to the right homes by notes pinned to their lapels. And though they held on to their own culture, they soon came to love their adopted home.
My father had a great voice. But he used to get home at between 9 and 10 o'clock. And the last thing he would do, he would sit on the middle of the big bridge, and he would say, we'd sing America, and then he would go to bed. Now, this one time, the Steels, down the other end, Mrs. Steele said, was telling the kids, now, it's time to go to bed to school tomorrow. And little Donald Steele piped up, and he said, oh, no, no, Ma. He says, Tony Sanchelli hasn't sung America yet.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood, from sea to shining sea.
Okay.
There it is. There's your house.
No, don't you because remember?
Their house is
on a sunny November day, not so long ago, we followed a reunion of Sweet Hollow kids back into the hollow of today. Some of them had not been down through the tunnel in over 50 years.
The Sweet Hollow was a great place to be poor. It was a great place to live. I never regret starting my life down there.
Mike Sanchelli was born at 17 North Phelan Creek in 1914 and grew up during the Depression in Sweet Hollow. At that time, the kids ran around in two groups called the Big Gang and the Little Gang, and all the families looked out for each other's children.
It was really nice. Really nice. We had Mexicans down here. We had Swedish people. We all got together. Sure. People were what they call togetherness.
The last group to live in the hollow were Mexican Americans. Most came north in the 1920s to work the sugar beet fields. Dozens of poor families filled the worst houses in the Twin Cities, including those along Phelan Creek.
I guess they would be what a lot of people refer to as tar paper shacks. I guess I just don't think of it as that we lacked for anything.
The houses were now filled with families with names like Bravo, Heredia, Sanchez. They hardly knew those who had moved up on the street before them, but they soon came to love the place just as much.
I say that I'm of the first group of that family. It was 12 of us. The second group was a little more fortunate. By that time, we had gotten jobs in the city, and we were here, and we were able to support and make it possible for them to get a better education. So their lives changed. Today, they can't even relate to this.
But to those who lived here, the memories are bittersweet. For in the 1950s, it all came to an end. In April 1954, they saw the Ham Mansion go up in flames. A 14-year-old boy set the fire out of boredom, he said. In the Depression, the house had been used for charity work, a place where caseworkers met with poor families. The last Ham to live here died in 1933, and the house became a nursing home. Luckily, it had been abandoned just a few weeks before the blaze. The boy started one fire on the first floor and two on the second. Then he called the fire department and waited for the police.
When they told me they burnt it down, I said it was a crime to burn the house, a beautiful place like that down. Yeah, it was a beautiful house.
By the time the mansion lay in ashes, the brewery's magnificent dome was gone, along with most of its Victorian trappings. Beginning in 1946, it all disappeared beneath a series of remodelings and expansions. The Theodore Ham Brewing Company was making its push to become a national brand.
From the land of sky blue waters, from the land of pines, lofty balsams, comes a beer refreshing, Ham's a beer refreshing,
Ham's. Ham's became the fifth largest brewing company in America. But eventually, the effort came up short, and in 1965, the Ham family sold out the business. In 1956, a project to redevelop St. Paul's East Side led to an investigation of Sweet Hollow. Health officials were amazed to find a situation they had ignored for 100 years. Since the people paid no property taxes, the city provided no services. They found 16 families living in 13 homes without sewer or water facilities.
People owned their houses down here. No matter what it was, they paid for their homes. But they were displaced, they were given no money to relocate, everybody had to go into apartments. They were given nothing.
On December 11th, 1956, on orders from the city, the St. Paul Fire Department used gasoline to set fire to the empty houses in Sweet Hollow. This unlikely little community was burned out of existence.
When the city fathers decided to close the Hollow and remove the last residents in 1956, in my opinion, they only turned down the volume. If you close your eyes today and listen really carefully, you can still hear the laughter of those immigrant children. You can hear the constant chatter of their geese and chickens and pigs that they lived in close harmony with, all with a backdrop of railroad noises, steam locomotives, train whistles. I don't know what we've lost. I think it's still here. I think it's still here. All over America, people still talk about their new world beginnings here in this Hollow. And they will be long after you and I are gone.
We've been waiting for you once again from the Wonder Showplace of the Northwest, the fabulous Prom Center in Midway on University Avenue, just off Lexington in St. Paul. Here's a half hour of music with personality.
The year was 1941. America had yet to join the war. And in St. Paul, Glenn Miller and his orchestra played the grand opening of the new Prom Ballroom on University Avenue. Close to 6,000 people packed inside. Another 3,000 had to be turned away. It was the age of the big band, and swing was king. And it seemed the Prom was the only place big enough to contain all the excitement. That night, the parade of stars had only begun. In the years to follow, there was Les Brown and his band of renown, the great Tommy Dorsey, and his brother Jimmy. Who could ever forget Count Basie? Or how about Harry James, with the flashing sticks of Buddy Rich on drums? And of course, the champagne music maker himself, Lawrence Welk.
Introducing tonight a brand new personality in the musical world, Lawrence Welk and his orchestra. Lawrence, do you remember those words? I said them once about 21 years ago.
I certainly do remember them, yes. Those were the first words we heard when we left the farm in the Midwest. That was our introduction to the nation.
Lawrence Welk not only got his start in the Twin Cities, but he brought together two people who would keep them dancing at the Prom for 35 years. Lois Best was Lawrence Welk's first champagne lady, and Jules Herman was in the brass section on trumpet. It was clearly only a matter of time before they made beautiful music together.
The owner, Kenneth W. Moore, the banker who owned the Prom, came up from Chicago, and he called me into the little office and said, we are considering a house band. How would you like to make St. Paul your home? So I took about 2 seconds and said, we'd like it very much.
The new home for the Jules Herman Orchestra had a reputation as one of the finest ballrooms anywhere.
One of the three or four in the United States. Palladium in L.A., Roseland in New York, Aragon and Trianon in Chicago, and the Prom were all in the same class.
The Prom was built like an airplane hangar with a dance floor, a beautiful 9,000 square foot hard maple floor, where the social grace of ballroom dance was practiced each and every week by thousands of dancers.
There isn't any other activity where you could be introduced to my wife for the first time, and you could say, Mrs. Given, may I have this next dance at some function, and take her in your arms in a romantic situation, and not do anything immoral or an act that wouldn't be as a complete gentleman.
On a typical night, people would buy their tickets in the lobby for 50 cents, 30 cents for the ladies, deposit their garments at the check room, and walk that long red carpeted hall to the main ballroom. Upon entering, their attention was drawn immediately to the stage, 35 feet across and framed in blue light. The Prom, if nothing else, cultivated a romantic setting.
There's one thing from Guy Lombardo at about 12:35, so to speak, the needle went in, and the music was geared to a romantic ending of the evening, and he wanted to be sure that the blue lights borders were turned down into a very, very romantic situation for the last 20 minutes of that dance. And when he finally got into it, it seems like, you know, Auld Lang Syne or Goodnight Sweetheart at the end of that thing, people were euphoric. I mean, they didn't know they were being used in a sort of a romantic situation. And he said, you go by this particular formula, and he said, you'll make lots and lots of friends.
Over in Minneapolis was the prom's main competition. The Marigold Ballroom on Nicollet Avenue had been making friends since 1919, when it opened as the Marigold Gardens. It was so popular in the 1920s and 30s that the Nicollet streetcar stopped right in front in the middle of the block to let off dancers. The sign read, "Never Grow Old Dancing at the Marigold." And aside from all the big names, local bands like Cease Hurst and Norby Mulligan kept the regulars coming back for more. The social atmosphere must have been intoxicating. There were 300 couples in the Cupid Club. That is, people who met at the Marigold and had such a good time, they danced all the way to the chapel.
The ballrooms like the prom and Marigold and Des Moines and those places were modern type dancing, 3-4 nights a week, and maybe one night would be what we call old time dancing, which didn't denote the age group at all, but the polka music.
To attract the old-time crowd, Harry Given was notorious for his wild promotions, including the time the prom gave away a live baby.
So we didn't tell anybody what the baby was. And so the welfare department served me notice 2 or 3 weeks before, and you can't do a thing like this. You can't give away a child like this. And we're going to arrest you. We're going to take away your dance license if you go ahead with this program. And I said, well, we're going to give away the live baby. So we had a nurse on the stage the night of the dance, and we called the names out, had the drawing, and the couple that came up were really excited about this, and she handed them this bathinet. I pulled it back, and the pig stuck its ears on. Well, all of these welfare people were there to arrest me. They just absolutely were furious that we'd tricked them. But anyway, the crowd loved it.
Now let's take time out in 1946 to go to another side of town, past little roadhouses on the north side of Minneapolis and up and down Rice Street in St. Paul. If you spoke the lingo, you'd know this is where the Hepcats blew their horns. So we'll take you north on Rice, just outside the city limits in what was then rural Ramsey County, where hot sepia dance music ruled the night at the Treasure Inn. It was a black-owned club whose life was brief but very full.
God bless Treasure Inn. Dick Mann, Howard Brown, Claude Mason.
We got our monies together, which amounted to approximately, I think we put in $150, $200 a piece. Claude did, and I did. And of course, Howard already had the place and had the license. Tore out the downstairs, made it a spacious bar-type nightclub, mainly for dancing, for blacks dancing, a place to go in the evenings, a place that they would be welcome to. It was black owned, etc.
At the end of the war, a young saxophone player named Percy Hughes was in an Army Ground Forces band, where he got to play with some of Duke Ellington and Count Basie's men. He then returned to the Twin Cities to front his own band, but it was not easy for black musicians in the 40s.
And here's Treasure Inn for us, a beginning. There weren't too many doors open for black musicians, and as a group, even less.
Percy himself was a big draw. There was a lot of musicians in Minneapolis, black jazz musicians in Minneapolis, as well as white musicians. And a lot of times they would come and sit in.
The guest stars read like a who's who of jazz. The great Oscar Pettiford on bass, Lester Young on saxophone, Prince Rogers Sr., that is, and Stan Kenton's boys would come out when they were in town. Radio personality and promoter Leigh Cammon discovered the place, and the Treasure Inn was included in a series of concerts. Its reputation was growing.
But it wasn't too long before we were drawing as many whites as we were blacks. We got a big clientele from the University of Minnesota, Hamline University, McAllister, all the college kids heard about the great jazz music we had at Treasure Inn. And so they started flocking out to the place. Our biggest problem was trying to keep out the minors. We had so many people there that we turned people away. We'd be down in the basement stoking the furnace or something like that, and they'd be dancing up above our heads, and you could see the floor swaying. So we finally got some 4x4s and shored up the floor to keep it from caving because it was scary, I'm telling you. We were in business for 2.5 years, and we had a problem out there. We had a problem just before we closed up.
There was an argument. And all of a sudden, there were gunshots. And then I remember kneeling behind, of all things, my music stand, which wouldn't stop a bullet. No way. And a dear friend of mine was killed. He was shot.
We weren't making a living in the place. I mean, there's three, when you had three persons in a place like that, we weren't making a living. I had another job. Howard was self-employed, and my brother had another job.
My heart just went out to Dick and Claude and Howard. But to see a club, black and white, and everyone just enjoying, there was a beautiful message there. We need more messages like that right now.
In the 50s, the birth of rock and roll meant the beginning of the end for the big bands, and eventually for the ballrooms.
That kind of music just took off just like that. And any kind of a nightclub or roadhouse could put in a rock and roll band, and it wasn't one of those things you necessarily would come to a big ballroom to participate in.
By the 1970s, the prom witnessed ballroom dancing dwindle to one night a week as the business moved to full-time catering. On May 24th, 1975, the Cupid Club danced its last waltz. The Marigold Ballroom would be the first to go. It was only a matter of time before the prom would follow.
Well, it was hard to believe that it was really going to be the last night. You just didn't have that kind of a feeling, you know. It was very nostalgic and very sad, but you didn't think about that when you're playing. It seemed like another regular Sunday night, and like, this can't be the end. But when you played that last note, it kind of sank in, as it is the end, you know.
On September 29th, 1987, the prom kept its date with the Wrecking Ball. And some in the crowd were more than casual observers. Some had come to say goodbye.
Jules Herman played there towards last, but they had all the name bands, Lawrence Welk, everybody.
Yeah, it's a sad thing.
Yeah, sad thing.
41 years. Every Sunday night.
Now speaking for Jules and the orchestra, vocalist Lois Best, pretty singer Louise Drake, engineer Vern Pearson, and all of the happy people here at the prom, this is Bob White wishing you a very pleasant good night.
For children, the biggest change in the 50s had to be television. And so many remember how thrilling it was when that first television set with its small, fuzzy picture and big rabbit ears appeared in their living rooms and opened up a whole new window on the world. And right here, that window was provided by a few frontier stations. KSTP led the way in 1948 with its first broadcast emanating from the prom ballroom. But soon enough, the airwaves were crowded with competition.
WTCN-TV, Twin Cities.
Over on Channel 9, a young Vern Gagne and All-Star Wrestling topped the ratings. WCCO-TV, Walter Cronkite turned down the anchor position, and the job went to a kid named Dave Moore. Oh, he's going to make an announcement.
The Twin Cities educational TV station, KTCA, carried its first program today, although regular programming won't start until September 16th.
Of course, Channel 2's programming was riveting stuff. But if you were a kid in the 50s, there was one show you ran home from school to watch.
Greetings from Magic Island.
Now here's Axel and his dog, starring Clellan Card as Axel. Away out in the forest, high in a big treehouse, lives our old friend Axel. Let's climb up the treehouse and see what's happening today.
Hi, kids, this is Axel, and Happy New Year to you all, being the very first day of the year. January 1st, 1956. Oh, Happy New Year to you all. I hope you will have a good year. Health and happiness, cast afterglow, and all of that sort of stuff. I don't know who's hollering the loudest here, but I know who ain't singing on key, and that ain't me.
There was Grandpa Ken on Channel 9, and there were Casey and Roundhouse on Channel 11, and they were great, but for whatever reason, it was Axel that, to me, seemed most like he was my friend.
Yeah, let's wave to Patty this morning, shall we? Hi, Patty, how are you? Say hello to the folks for me. We'll be over to borrow a cup of sugar very shortly.
The man behind the striped shirt, the funny mustache, and the twisted Scandahoovian accent was Clellan Card, and his was by far the most popular children's show of its day. Not even national shows could touch Axel and his dog, which enjoyed a 12-year run on Channel 4. By the time he came to television, Clellan Card was already an established radio star.
It's Duncan at the card table, time and temperature.
And starring the Joker himself, your guiding light and protecting arm, Clellan Card.
Well, hi, little diddler. And a happy Thursday, November 1st to you all.
He was famous for his crazy characters, including Grandma Sykes, Jessica Jigglebustle, and Teakwood Torgerson, an early variation of Axel. It was on radio where he first recited his rendition of The Night Before Christmas, so popular it became a yearly tradition.
More faster than eagles, his horses they came, and he whistled and hollered and called them all names. On Tackhead, on Stupid, on Saskansen.
But as he made the switch to television, tragedy seemed to change the course of his career. In September of 1952, Clellan's oldest son, Peter, was killed in a plane crash. Just 4 months later, his second son, John, was killed in a car accident just a few blocks from his home.
I don't think it's a coincidence that really for the rest of his life, his career revolved around children.
The son says, "May I have a dime, Pop? When I was a boy, I only asked for pennies." "All right, may I have 10 pennies, Pop?" Can't get around these kids. They're all smart, aren't they?
He had this way of saying things that drove my mother nuts. She was an English teacher, and she was absolutely convinced that her kids were going to grow up talking like Axel.
What is a volcanoid? Volcanoid. Volcanoid, it says there.
Volcano.
Volcano, that's what I says. What did Franklin say when he discovered electricity? What's the best thing to put in a hot dog?
I can remember at dinner, instead of saying, "Mom, would you please put some meatloaf on my plate?" It was, "Would you please pute some meatloaf on my plate?" And she'd say, "Oh, that Axel."
The best thing to pute in a hot dog is your teeth.
Axel's companions in the treehouse were Towser the dog and Tallulah the cat, who remained unseen except for their paws. The show relied on the children to use their imaginations to fill in the rest, which is why the following outtake was never seen at home.
Say, I see a sign.
Hello, kids, this is Tallulah. Hello.
My nerves are frazzled. Gee whiz.
And I never felt any embarrassment at all about being nothing but a paw. I loved it.
Actor Don Stoltz played both aminals, and he and Card quickly became an effective comedy team, entertaining adults and children alike with humor that was live and unrehearsed.
This dog comes leaping at me, you know, and he wants to sit in my lap all the time. He's only about umpteen feet tall, you know.
Well, he would go, "Rumph!" And then at other times he'd get excited, "Rumph, rumph, 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 rumph."
Say, I think it would be nice if the kids would send us some pictures of what they think you look like, huh? Rumph!
He was fun, but it wasn't as much fun as Tallulah, who goes,
"Meow, well, no, I don't want to do that. Far away over the hill."
The farther the better. Get back a little farther behind that tree over there so I can't see you. Sharon Westfall over to Kenyon, Minnesota.
Farther hills and farther away.
Has anybody got a gun or anything I could use?
Clellan often would just say whatever popped into his head at the time, and sometimes it was maybe not the best idea.
One time he said, well, now you know, kiddies, we've been up now for at least an hour, and I'll bet your mommy and daddy are still in bed, so why don't you go get a glass of water and go into the bedroom and throw it in their face and say, good morning, time to get up.
And we played Yerk. Did you ever play Yerk? Yerk, oh, that's one of the more educational types. You try this, kids. It's more exciting, see? Now, after you're through eating breakfast, see, all the stuff setting on the table, you take a hold of the tablecloth very firmly in both hands, see, and all of a sudden like that, and it doesn't even move anything on the table.
The character of Axel became a local phenomenon, and he was in great demand for personal appearances. When WCCO sponsored an Axel Day at the Excelsior Amusement Park, over 12,000 kids showed up to see their hero.
Another thing I remember that he used to do is he would have the kids send in riddles and knock-knock jokes, and he read one of my knock-knock jokes on the air. And it was, knock-knock, who's there? Old lady who? Oh, I didn't know you could yodel. And then he laughed, and he read my name over the air, and I thought, I'm immortal. Axel spoke my name on television.
In the fall of 1954, Clellan Card had been taken ill suddenly, and a substitute was needed on short notice. Director Harry Jones recruited Mary Davies, a local singer and entertainer, and Carmen the Nurse was born.
And he just loved to see somebody crack up. Most of the time, I just lose it. It was very hard to keep, and I think that's what he loved.
Did Grandma Torgerson let you use her slingshot?
She gave me the first line spring.
You're having one of your attacks again, aren't you, Carmine?
Wasn't that possible?
Your onion is running.
I never knew why he opted to have me around as long as he did, but I think it was because he struck me funny.
She continued to fill in as a guest hostess, and soon kids came to think Carmen was taking care of Axel when he was sick.
Well, I suppose I'll have to be running along now, and the usual thing winds up our treehouse session, you know.
Every show ended with a birdie.
Birdie with the yellow bill hopped upon my windowsill, cocked, how did it go, cocked his?
Birdie with the yellow bill hopped upon my windowsill, cocked his shining eye and says, what do you think this is, Mary? Christmas?
There were hundreds of them, and they were all really bad.
What did you do when you sat on the bed? Spring? What did you do after you ate the ginger? Snap? What's the trouble with the baby? Buggy?
But they were so bad, and Axel delivered it with such panache that you really almost had to laugh.
What was your boyfriend's name, Jesse? James? Well, I'll see you, Tosser. Stop it.
Few people outside the station were aware that Clellan had battled cancer for quite some time. He kept working as long as he could, but the disease took its toll, and he finally went into the hospital. On April 13th, 1966, Clellan Card died. The next day, Carmen the nurse went on the air and told the children Axel would not be coming back.
I just remember seeing something about that he might want us to go on meeting together in Magic Island, and he did have to go. I didn't want to say to the... You don't want to tell children that somebody they've loved like that died. They don't understand death, per se.
And see, I'd never had anybody close to me at that point in my life die. I mean, when somebody died, it was somebody that I didn't know. It was an experience that I really couldn't identify with very much. But then when this happened, it was like, ooh, you know, Axel's gone. This is a guy who I was friends with, and he's not coming back. They had I believe it was called the Clellan Card Memorial Fund. And I remember taping some coins to a postcard and then putting the postcard inside the envelope and addressing it to the WCCO studios downtown. And I believe that they collected around $5,000 or $6,000. I think they said that about half that money came from kids that sent in their pennies, their nickels, their dimes, and their quarters.
Something that'll never happen again. It was a newness, a freshness, and a life that nobody will ever know. It was a gift to us.
If I have given the impression that he was a remarkable man, I'm glad, because he was. Talented in a strange and unique way. He was a striking man, an impressive man, and a ridiculous man with that mustache.
The age of tail fins and bomb shelters is long gone now, and it's hard to know exactly what to make of it. For those who grew up in the 50s, the era seems to possess a kind of distant innocence, like childhood itself. The 50s weren't innocent, of course, but it was quite a party while it lasted. As we look back now, we can see that destroying the past is not the only way to create a better future. It's always the fate of the new to become the old. And the great irony of the post-war era is that so much of what was made with easy confidence is already beginning to disappear. Could we have stayed the wrecking ball? Should we have saved more? Certainly. But so much disappeared, not by accident or neglect, but because times change and people change. Our children don't socialize in ballrooms or hang out at drive-ins, and local TV heroes are a thing of the past. We can never go back, but we can keep those times alive in our hearts through the pictures, the music, and through each other. And to be sure, that's the next best thing.